The other thing to remember is everything we're doing is an attempt to meet a need. So if we're trying to give advice, what need are we trying to meet? We're always trying to meet our own needs. And we're also, one of our biggest needs is to contribute to others. So advice is often about really trying to contribute to others. Our need is to contribute to others. If we start sharing our own story, what need might we be trying to meet?
To be
heard. To be heard. We might need empathy, actually, which is very fun. If we're trying to distract and avoid, what need are we trying to meet, maybe? I'm saying, no, you shouldn't make such a big deal out of it.
Or you feel uncomfortable by hearing the story.
Yeah. So what need are we trying to meet?
Harmony.
Comfort. Mm-hmm. Before I started MVC, I usually would either do advice or humor or share my own story. Mm-hmm. It was offered to try to meet my need for comfort because I wasn't comfortable in the realm of emotions and so on. So I'm going to speak a little bit about the brain then and how it works with emotions, just so you have a little more understanding of what we're doing when we're using the different types of responses, particularly empathy. And I invite you to do it with me, because it'll help you probably remember it better. So this is the brain and the palm of the hand, and it comes from interpersonal neurobiology. If you're interested, there's a book on that table that I recommend. It's called Mindset. So if this is your brain up here, this would be your spine. And right about here would be your brain stem, which is also known as the reptilian brain. It does a bunch of things. One of them is it makes sure that the heart's going and all the automatic functions are happening and so on, as well as other things. Over top of the brain stem and reptilian brain is the limbic system, also known as the, anybody know?
Midbrain.
The mammalian brain, midbrain, yeah, it's kind of in the mid there too. The mammalian brain has, or the limbic system has different parts. One of them is that amygdala that I talked about. So there's emotions being generated in the limbic system by the amygdala. It also has the hippocampus, which stores memory, and as well as does other things there too. And over top of the limbic system is that cortex, the outer layer that's all creviced and folded and so on. So, what's this part here?
Reptilian
or
brainstem.
Mammalian or
limbic
system.
Neocortex.
The cortex has a lot of functions. The part that for today is really relevant is the middle prefrontal cortex, right about here. It has the capacity for empathy. For empathy for the self and empathy for others. It has the capacity for regulating, for calming the amygdala. It also has the capacity for regulating the body systems.
Executive decisions, executive functions.
Executive decisions and functions. Morality, a sense of morality. When you pause before responding, you're using, you know, when you're thinking of this, should I really throw my pen at that person? Should I shout at them right now? No, I shouldn't. So, so here we have that amygdala generating emotion. Now, the amygdala is really interested in how safe do I feel in the world. And because as mammals, our safety is directly linked to how connected we feel, the amygdala is always trying to sense how connected am I to get a sense of how safe am I.
Am I safe? Do I matter?
Am I safe? Do I matter? Or I like to say, am I safe? Do I belong? Am I safe? Am I accepted? Anything in that realm. Four times a second, apparently, the amygdala is assessing the environment. Because its job is to keep us alive. As soon as it senses any threat to that, it generates the emotions to let us know that we need to fight or run or just shut down and collapse. And if we don't have any regulating neural networks from the prefrontal cortex to the amygdala, and the amygdala takes over, and we start going, "Aah!" or "Aah!" or
shoots cortisol throughout the system. Cortisol impairs the connectivity between our executive functions and emotional reactions.
So we're not born with regulating, virtually any regulating neural networks between the prefrontal cortex and the amygdala.
It's like dark space if you were to look at it through a functional MRI.
So, and that's pretty obvious for those of us who've spent time around little infants and toddlers. They're going, "Ah!" Right? They're not going, "Well, I feel really upset." I feel tense here, and I think I need comfort. Right? Just, "Ah!" And what they need is caregivers, parents and caregivers who have a regulated brain, who can give them empathy, resonant care and responsiveness. Mm-hmm. Parents and caregivers who are attuned, they notice all the signals, and they can start guessing at their needs and reflecting their emotions. And the more they get that, the more the self-regulating emotional networks develop. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of us didn't get that. So this is essentially the right hemisphere I'm talking about. The right hemisphere as the stronger emotions being generated. So if we're getting lots of attuned, resonant support, then we grow up to have capacity to feel without getting overwhelmed and flooded. Please keep jumping in anytime. If we don't, if there just isn't room, like there wasn't in my family or my parents' families, there wasn't room to have big emotions to really need, then we learn to cut off from that and try to live from our left hemisphere, where we start to not feel a whole lot. The left hemisphere has the capacity to feel pleasant things. It can be humorous, it can be mild irritation, and feel happy, sort of a light happiness. But as soon as it's a stronger feeling, that's the realm of the right hemisphere. If we don't have either self-empathy or we have people to turn to for empathy, then the left hemisphere's got to take over and do whatever it can to sort of calm this side of things or at least ignore it altogether. So the way my left hemisphere has done that is through, in my lifetime, many different ways. I've been a workaholic, I've done extreme sports to escape this, used alcohol, I've used food, still use food, internet. What are other ways people are? Phone is a good way. So, did you have?
Oh, I just said distraction. There's a lot of distraction.
There's no shortage of ways to distract.
Yeah.
Television was
the one. Yeah. Video games for me when I was a kid was a great way to escape.
Oh, just if we had a kind of a model, I'd put like the left brain as this tennis ball with Velcro on it, kind of stuck to the right brain. The right brain has the long axons, the long nerves that go down to the body and get all the body information up to the right hemisphere. But the left hemisphere doesn't get it. It's kind of stranded on its own unless it goes through the right brain. So there has to be this going back and forth and integration between the two hemispheres in order to be kind of in your body, basically. And the left brain can confabulate, can just make up stuff on its own. It can hyper-focus on details and doing and instead of relating. And it can be lost when it comes to relationship and attunement.
Emotion. Intimacy.
Self-knowledge.
And then sometimes people say, well, I thought the left hemisphere was connected to the right side of the body. And that's true, but only on a surface level. When Mika says that the right hemisphere is getting the information from the body, she's talking about the emotional information, the visceral information. So that's quite a bit of information. I just want to pause and see, are there any questions? What's standing out for people? Anything that anyone wants to ask?
Oh, so people who are working in largely left brain dominant fields would probably feel more likely to be disconnected in relationship with people perhaps sometimes, if they practice that all the time?
Well, there's different complexities. So I'm a recovering left hemisphere person. I love my left hemisphere. I need my left hemisphere. But left hemisphere can be quite charming and funny. Mm-hmm. So I could be, quote unquote, like this funny, gregarious guy. I also can be quite introverted, but so it could look like in some ways, you know, a colleague of ours who talks about a lot of this, she'll say it's going to be so confusing because the people in the left hemisphere can be quite charming and generous and so on, and then they go home to their families and their families don't get any real intimacy and emotional connection and vulnerability. So it can look like they're actually quite personable until it gets to any vulnerability and intimacy. Or it can get to an extreme where they don't even have much charm and funny. They're very, like, they feel actually way safer with a screen or a, yeah.
Their faces could be immobile.
Yeah. I saw Lorna and then we'll come on.
The extreme left location, could that be connected to people who are in some degree autistic?
I'm not a real expert on autism, so I don't have an answer. Do you have an answer?
Yes, they're talking about the autism spectrum now and how every person has a different makeup. So it's a bigger question than I can answer. But sometimes the relational skills could be taught to people if they're younger who have autism.
So the other possibility is that when we're growing up, we're having emotions, we're reaching out, and the responsiveness, there is some responsiveness. We're not getting told that there's no room for emotions, that there's no room for intimacy. So there's some responsiveness, but it's not consistent. Sometimes it's there, sometimes it's not. Sometimes when it's there, it's intrusive. It's not on the child's terms, it's more on the parents' terms. Sometimes the parents just dealing with their own dysregulated right hemisphere, so they're missing signals and this is getting kind of messy. And so then the child learns non-consciously that, oh, it's okay to have emotions, but I can't trust that someone's going to be there who's regulated enough to help me build these neural networks. And it's okay to have intimacy, but I can't trust that someone's going to meet me there fully, and so on. And so they're having more right hemisphere experience, but it's not regulated. They're getting flooded more easily and overwhelmed by emotion. And, you know, these are generalities. I hesitate about putting people into too many categories, but that is what can happen in the brain development. Extreme left hemisphere living is called avoidant attachment. When it's the other non-consistent responsiveness, that's called ambivalent or anxious attachment, where I really want the connection, but I can't trust it's there. So
these things show up just in people, whenever there's more than in groups of people, because our amygdala just is scanning, and the amygdala is not very precise. It will just take the roughest thing and relate it back to a threat. And so we can get triggered by the slightest. It could be lack of facial movement. It could be tone of voice. Sometimes it's hard to pinpoint when we get triggered, but our bodies could take over in 14 milliseconds and have a reaction to something that's even below consciousness. So this is why the practice of empathy and NVC and attunement, it's actually building neural matter, building our brains.
That's the hopeful and exciting part. This is neuroplastic. We can develop this throughout our whole life.
And it's the attachment circuit that's the most neuroplastic.
So I'm just going to explain one more thing and then I'll come over to you. So coming back to the whole empathy and so on, that, as I said before, this amygdala loves to be understood. That's what helps to bring this self-regulating, more and more connected at the level of feelings and at the level of needs. But also the right hemisphere wants to sense that someone gets me with their energy and their emotional state. So, for example, you can do empathy from pretty left hemisphere. Can we give a little example? Like if you're quite upset and I'm...
I can't believe it. I'm watching this coworker struggle with this situation, and I just don't know what to do. Anything I say, it's like water off a duck's back. Just no way to help this person.
Mika, are you feeling scared or anxious? Do you need reassurance?
Yeah, it's a bit more than reassurance.
So there's not a lot of resonance, which is what the right... So let's do that again, and I'll bring the right hemisphere into the picture. You notice I'm using empathy words, but it's not landing.
Doesn't fit that.
Yeah.
So can you say that basically the same thing?
I can see this person's in pain. It's about their domestic situation, and I just don't know what to do.
Oh, so are you feeling kind of worried, and are you longing for some reassurance or some way to contribute here?
Yeah, just something that could make a difference.
You want to make a difference. So I'm trying to meet them where they're at energetically. And that, the left hemisphere makes sense of the words, but the right hemisphere doesn't. The right hemisphere is picking up on nonverbal communication, the eye contact, the body language, the tone of my voice. You know,
if you're genuine or not.
If I'm genuine, and if the emotional quality, the energetic quality. It's not that I'm trying to feel what they're feeling, but I'm trying to meet them in their state. So if someone's in despair, I'm not trying to feel despair, but I'm bringing a very tender energy with them. If they're enraged, then I'm amping up. I'm not trying to be enraged, but I'm trying to be a powerful container to hear their empathy. So that's a very important piece. This is a very important piece, because when I started doing MVC, I was doing it all left hemisphere. And I kept hearing things from mostly my partners, that, Eric, I'm hearing the words, but I'm not feeling the empathy. Right? And which was really hard for me to hear, because as an avoidant person, I thought I was doing so well, being so connecting, and to hear that I wasn't. You know, it was true, though. I wasn't in my right hemisphere. I was trying to solve it, really, was what I was doing. If I just do this empathy thing, hopefully she'll feel better, and then we'll come back to something that feels more comfortable for me, which is happy or fine. So I saw another hand. Lucia, do you still have a question?
I'm just wondering if the person is more in the left hemisphere and all the good thing didn't happen growing up, do they then need somebody who can be that person for them to help them develop the connection, or is there a way of doing it on your own, the healing process? I would kind of assume we would still need somebody who can help us develop the connection, right?
Yeah, do you want to put
that on? Like developmentally, in a couple?
Like what the parent normally would do for a child to develop that.
Right.
So we're adults, the parents are not going to do that for us.
I guess being an avoidant person myself, I like to have choice and space. And so sometimes help can be someone just trusting that I'll get back to them in my own time. And then I'm actually come back with a more open heart. So. Sometimes you don't have to actually do anything, but hold them mentally with care. And other times, if the person is willing and open to exploring a bit, then offering them just a few, not flooding them with empathy, but just offering a few empathetic, even looks or words once in a while, can build the trust. Yeah, I think so. Attachment repair, build the trust that way.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's helpful.
The other thing, I don't know if this is part of your question, but I'll see if it is. I'm also, as I said, recovering, the left hemisphere, avoidant is my family history. To come back to reclaiming the right hemisphere and emotions is not something I think I could have done on my own.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I need to regain trust that I can open up and be received with a right hemisphere response. And through that, I've slowly become a person who can feel again. I have lots of room to grow with that, don't get me wrong, but that I've come a long way in being able to have emotions again and being able to care for others and be intimate and so on. I don't think I could have gone very far just on my own. Because that break happened in relationship, and really it's much more powerful if we're healing in a relationship. There are things we can do. In fact, I have a self-empathy handout. So we can hold ourselves with compassion, but it's really hard to just do it on our own.
It's almost like we need the training wheels of other people showing us care and nurturing so that we can internalize it for ourselves.
Okay. Any other questions before we move on from there? So we're going to move...
I guess we just wanted to share this to say that this is why it's so tricky, communication.
Yeah.
So much is going on all different levels. And if something is reminding us of the past and our own triggers, then that's part of the what's in the room.
Yeah, I just had a question. I guess it touches on the autism question she had, because I'm a teacher. And, I mean, sometimes we just do feel like we have students. You know, we almost say like they're like a future sociopath or something. Mm. They have no feelings. Can someone actually be damaged? Like have some kind of brain damage from either like the alcohol syndrome or drug alcohol effect? Something that damages that ability? Because just, you know, to deal with students who have just no empathy and no, like you said, they immediately, they don't ever think. It's almost like the 2-year-old still. They're still just
Striking that. That attachment circuit is the most neuroplastic of all the circuits in the brain, so there's always hope. But okay. There can be physical brain damage. People's brains are scanned, or did you hear about that study where the guy was a brain neuroscientist and he was studying psychopaths? And then he realized, did a scan on his own brain and noticed he had the same structure. But I don't know, very simplistic answer to your question.
I just wondered if...
I would like to add that I think there's always hope that people can move at least baby steps from where they are. Mm-hmm. My general... attitude is the more difficult someone is, my assumption, I guess, is that the more difficult their childhood was, the more abuse they had, the more neglect. And the best way I'm going to be able to help them is if I get a lot of empathy for whatever comes up with me, and then be able to try to keep meeting them where they're at and finding ways to gently help them regain trust. So that's
what I do is I try to bring them closer.
Yeah.
Like you know, like you're gonna be my
beautiful
friend.
As long as that works. Anything you can do to increase the connection in a way that they don't feel coerced or things.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's kind of Gordon Neufeld type strategy. I don't know if you're aware of him, but instead of punishing and decreasing connection, you try to build it in creative ways that they don't even realize it's happening.
Yeah, I got come help me do this.
Yeah.
Exactly. Is Gordon Neufeld's work connected to this mindsight?
It's in the realm of attachment for sure. And mindsight is kind of the neurobiology of attachment. He speaks about attachment theory in that book. So, yeah. Gordon Neufeld doesn't get into the neurobiology of it so much. He just speaks about relationship. And he doesn't include empathy, which is fine. It's a kind of a shame because empathy is such a beautiful thing. Okay, so I'd like to do a little bit of movement just because I need it and to warm up a little bit too. And then we'll move on. So first, one thing I like to do to warm up, you can do whatever you like. It's just to breathe in through my nose when I go up and out when I go down. And then hold your breath in as you pull up. then we're going to take everything that we don't want to hold into our hands. We're going to hold it up. Hold it up high. And just get ready to throw it. Hold it all. And on the count of three, we're going to throw it down into the ground while we say no. One, two, three, no!
No!
Oh.
Oh.
Oh. Oh. And then we realize, oh, there's more. I don't want to. So we reach through. Oh, yeah. Oh. One, two, three, no!
No!
Oh. One last time. Reach. No!
No!
This part of my one of my other friends does this one really well. Then we just hold laughter.
Too much noise in here. Sounds like you're having too much fun.
All right, one last thing before we move on.
She just wants to check the thermostat.
So Dave, you could just count me.
Yeah.
Choose somebody in the circle without letting them know who it is.
Oh.
Pick one person. When I say go, you're going to circle around this person three times. Go! Okay, so we're going to finish up with restorative systems and circles, and here we go. So, restorative systems and circles, I learned this from someone named Dominic Barter. I'm going to give you the brief version so that we can cover the material more. Dominic Barter is from England, and he was traveling, living in Brazil, really loving it there, and kept hearing about how dangerous the favelas were, the shanty towns. Don't go there, it's so dangerous. And he finally decided he was going to go and try to feel safer by connecting with the danger rather than trying to protect and escape the danger. And so he went, and the only people that he was able to connect with at first were the children. And he saw the immense poverty and so on. And he saw whatever he saw, actually. I don't remember the words he used. But he felt moved to contribute. And so what he noticed was that each time he offered something he thought would be a wonderful contribution, for example, let's start building community gardens. You can feed each other with healthy food. Or let's create a local currency so you can build your economy that way. He noticed generally that there would be less connection. And then each time they asked him for something they really wanted, like we want to learn English, we want to learn computers, each time he heard that and tried to support what they wanted, it increased connection. So he stopped coming up with things to offer and just started listening, what did they want, and tried to do his best. And he didn't really like teaching English or computers, so he'd try to find others that would come and help. And then they asked him, we want help with our fights. Meaning that they would play soccer, and when there would be fights, they weren't happy with how that would go. So they said, can you help us with our fights? And that was something he was very interested in. And so for over 15 years, he's been helping different people in Brazil to create... I'm going to backtrack. He's developed restorative systems with the people in the shanty towns and so on together they figured out different ways that really worked for them to deal with their fights. He also did go and study some restorative justice and lots of nonviolent communication. So sort of they brought those things together. He's very clear that he doesn't take the full credit, that it was all of them working together. So I'm trying to honor that. So there's two different levels here that they were working on. One was the systemic level, and one was the direct level of when we're actually responding to the conflict. And they're both important, but he would generally say you need to start with the system, and I kind of agree. So the system, is any kind of group of two or more people, really. So you can build a restorative system for a co-housing community. You can build it for a school. You can build it for a family. You can build it for a relationship, for two people. And building the system involves, I'll wait till those handouts go around. Take a sip of water. So first of all, in a restorative system, restorative means that the intention is to restore connection. That's what we're trying to restore. We're not trying to restore property. That might be part of it, but the underlying principle is to restore connection.
Were there two sheets or
one? No, just one.
Thank you.
Yeah. And there are several pieces. One piece is that there's an acceptance that conflict is a natural part of life. That happens regularly, and we can, if we accept it, then we're going to embrace it, actually. It's part of our life, part of what happens. It's what I believe. Anytime two or more people spend regular time together, there will be conflict. Mm-hmm. Conflict might be completely ignored, and everyone's pretending it's not there, or just doesn't feel like there's any use in trying to address it. Or it can be responded to in any number of ways, including punitively and restoratively and so on. So there's an acceptance that conflict is a natural part of life in a restorative system. The definition that I use for conflict, which is based on Dominic's definition, is that it's information that comes into the system that's hard to integrate, hard to process and integrate. So that definition is right at the top of that sheet. Dominic uses I haven't worked with him for a while, but the one he was using when I was with him was that it's information coming into a system. And I just found that people had too hard of a time with that. So I changed it to it's difficult information to process and integrate. He wants to normalize conflict, so he's saying it's anytime information comes in, and he wants to acknowledge that we're working with conflict all the time. So if you're driving to work, you're a little late, and there's a red light, that's information that's coming into your system. And we generally integrate it, process it, and on we go. Or we get an email from someone, it's not the email we wanted, it's difficult to process and integrate, and so on. And then we get to the further extremes where, okay, now it's really difficult to process and integrate. It's impacting me and our group and costing us and so on. And that's where we want to build something to address it. So when a group decides, okay, we want a restorative system, then they start with, this is the suggestion. Let me backtrack and say, let's say someone in a group decides, I really want to have a better way of working with our conflict than what I've experienced. the suggestion is to start with these questions that are the next piece, exploring conflict. As opposed to that person going to the group and saying, we're not doing conflict very well, I think we should do it this way. That's sort of analogous to Dominic going and saying, hey, you guys should build a garden, you should have local currency. In general, people don't like to have things imposed upon them. They like to be part of creating solutions that work for them, that they have a say in, and so on. So the suggestion is, any group could be your friend, could be your spouse, could be your children, could be your coworkers, could be your causing community. But the starting place is, hey, let's get together and have a dialogue about conflict. For anyone who wants to. Choice and autonomy are huge values in restorative systems. As soon as you start trying to coerce and force, obviously you're not, it's going to make it hard to restore a connection when you're using the force. So you invite whoever wants to have the dialogue, and you start with those questions. So how do we respond to conflict right now? What are we doing about it? What's working for us? That's a wonderful question to acknowledge that, you know, we don't want to just look at the negatives. There are things that are already working. But we also want to address what isn't working so well. And then, number four, what is our dream? What would we love to create for our response to So that's something you can take away from today, right now, and start with anybody, any system of two or more beings that you're interested in changing your response to conflict, these questions. If that's as far as you get, it'll probably be an interesting conversation. Okay, so let's go down to these last five. These are what Dominic calls the five conditions of restorative system. So one is engage. So you have the dialogue, the questions, and you reach an agreement on a certain response, a certain process to use for your conflict, which can be whatever you want to try. It could be mediation. It could be something that's more like restorative justice. It could be some process like shadow work. Whatever your committee is interested in trying out. Could be NVC dialogues, could be restorative circles. So you come to some agreement on some process that you're going to try within your system. Then you find a space, a designated space. It doesn't have to be only used for the conflict, but it's the space that is designated for conflict. And it works best in the restorative sense if it's a neutral space. So in a school, you wouldn't use the principal's office for your conflict because it has all kinds of associations with authority and power and so on. So whatever your structural thing is, you want to find a room, a space that is neutral. And then you could even decorate it in a way that speaks to restoration, connection, whatever, maybe there's artwork and so on. Some way that symbolizes or represents frustration and shared power. Number three, you need the resources. Whatever process you're choosing, you need to have the resources to implement it. So if you're going to choose mediation, well then you need someone who's got skill in mediation. The idea with the restorative system is that you're doing your own conflict, right? So when Dominic was going into the favelas, he wanted to help them create something they could do without needing outside help. And that's how this is different from restorative justice. Restorative justice is, in general terms, an organization that does restorative justice, which is way better still than the punitive system. But you bring them in, they do the restorative justice, and they go. And then the next time conflict arises, you use them again or you do something else. In restorative system, you're actually attempting to do it on your own. And whatever you're doing it with, you need the resources, the training, and the materials, and so on. And then you inform everyone involved about all of it, the space, the process, the training, and it's all transparent. So for example, not everyone in a co-housing community might want to start up a restorative system, but those who are creating it, make sure that everyone does have access to the information of it. So if they ever decide to be a part of it, they already know what's going on and how it works as much as they want to know. And then finally, initiation. You come up with a way to initiate whatever process that you're using that's equally accessible, that works, that's easy. So I was helping a school one time, and they had a locker that was empty, and that locker was the initiation locker, where if you had a conflict in the school, you would write that you wanted support, you wanted to start a restorative circle, and you'd slide that paper in between the little vents of the locker, and then the facilitators, the ones that were trained in restorative circles, would check that locker regularly, and then see, oh, someone wants to restart it, and they would get the process going. Another time I helped a faculty at a college. They wanted their system, and theirs to initiate it was an email or a phone call. They had two different options. And they wanted to get very specific about the wording that was going to be used in the email or the phone call. Because they really wanted to feel safe from start to finish. So I helped them with some NVC wording about that first email. It would say something like, there's something that came up for me in regards to you, and I'd love to get together and do a restorative process so we can find mutual understanding about this. It was something in that realm. It's been a couple of years. And we worked on that wording until everyone felt good about it. And at one point, someone still wasn't feeling good about it. I said, great, how can we tweak it further? And that person finally said, you know what, you can't. I just realized I'm just afraid of conflict. You could word it however you wanted, and I would still be afraid. That's just my stuff to get more comfortable. Any questions so far about these pieces of our restorative system?
Basically, it's to start a dialogue, find out where people are at, what they want, or imposing anything, or instead of imposing anything.
Yeah.
And then to co-create it and have the resources to back it up.
I like that. I like the kind of little tickle there of before imposing.
Before imposing, yeah, no, scratch that.
It's a rigid mock, never going to impose anything.
Can you say just a little bit more about initiation?
Yeah. So I'm gonna just start referencing restorative circles now. So I'm gonna assume there's a group of people who want to set up a restorative system and they want to use restorative circles. That's the reference. In restorative circles, you have at least two facilitators who facilitate the process that we're gonna get to in a second. And they're also the ones who get the whole process going. So they need to be contacted somehow. So perhaps the initiation method is that they get sent an email by someone in the community. So let's say Jenna and I are we're designated facilitators of restorative circles. Mika's in our community of co-housing. She emails Jenna and says, whatever we agreed upon, maybe the subject line is, I want to initiate a restorative circle. And then whatever the subject is, please, here are the times that work for me, and boom, we're on our way. So another time it might be a box that we have that's locked, and it might be a phone call, whatever it is, that gets the whole thing going. The next step will be that the facilitator meets with that person, and we're going to talk about that in the next step and the next one. Does that answer that question?
So Eric, this could be, in this example, this could be the first time that Mika had heard, even realized there was a conflict. So it could be bugging Jenna. Jenna is initiated, and Mika would get the email saying, oh, well, in other words, the two people in conflict may not have spoken to each other. One person, Mika may have been doing something that was really annoying for the other person, or oblivious to that. And is that, is it that sort of that initiation process? Is it that early, or is this sort of?
So it depends again on the process you're using. So in a restorative circle process, there would hopefully be enough facilitators that one of them wouldn't be directly involved in the conflict, and then the person initiating would contact that facilitator and say, "I'd like to get a process going," and they would get it going. In the nursing example, a real example, they didn't use restorative circles because they just didn't have the resources to train in it. What their process was to basically, I've got an abbreviated restorative circle process that people can use just one-on-one, and I talk to them. So they agreed they would do that process, and then they would agree if it wasn't working, they would get a third party within their cohort to help them, so on. So in that case, the initiation was directly to the person who was on the other end of the conflict. And that's why I was so careful with the wording. Where it was something like, hey, Mika, something happened yesterday at that meeting that didn't feel good for me, and I would like to get together so we can find mutual understanding about it. And then because we built the system, Mika knows, oh, there's that email that we together agreed on, and I know what's happening, and either I'm going to say yes, or I'm going to say, you know what, I don't feel comfortable, I want to get that third-party person, and on we go. This is why the system is so important, because if we're all contributing to building it, we all know what's happening, and we can all help it actually implement it. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. So it's a system availability. That's sort of like this optional path. You know, you can go through mediation, you can go through arbitration, you can go through a community, you can go through a circle to start something. And whoever's, you know, for that conflict, it sounds like that everyone who's involved in that is kind of signed up to participate in it. But it sounds like it isn't an obligation. So if the timing isn't right, if you just don't want to deal with that issue right now, you can still say thanks but no thanks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in terms of the options that are available, that's for you to decide as you're building your system. Mm. You might only have the one option, you might have two. Okay. But you need to have the resources to implement whatever options that you're...
So you've helped schools and organizations set up their own systems, and that would be... another day's workshop or another.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah. The intention today is just to introduce you to some things and give you a bit of a sense, and then if we want to continue from there, that's something we can explore.
Can you just speak a little bit more about shadow work? You mentioned shadow work.
I'm going to try to keep this very brief because we're running out of time, but I'm passionate about shadow work. So, coming back to our childhood, anything that caregivers and society in general can't love and accept about us goes into the shadow. Because as mammals, we need to feel connected to caregivers in order to feel like we can survive. So, you know, vulnerability wasn't acceptable in my family, boom, into my shadow. As soon as I start to get close to others, if I'm not working with my shadow, then when someone shows me something that's in my shadow, I'm going to have a strong reaction to them and judge and blame and try to shut them down and so on, because they're showing me a part of me that I never got to accept. Okay. I happen to think it's a pretty good.
So what does that look like if you're dealing with that at a community level? Are you looking at the community shadow and figuring out what the community shadow is? Or are you talking about individuals?
Well, this comes back to building the system. If you want it to be part of your conflict system, then you need to get resources to get supported in working with your shadow.
So it's looking, not not necessarily collectively, but that's individual work.
Can be both.
That's that, a, yeah, that's a good question, I mean, because every culture, I can see that every culture would have a shadow, right?
Yeah. There's some individual, there's an individual shadow.
Yeah.
You know, the NBC community tends to have a shadow around things like anger and use of power, right? A lot of, you know, I don't want to start getting generalizations, but yes, different communities can have different shadows, and that's why they form, because there's, they have a shared maybe thing that they haven't been able to accept. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we're going to move into the actual restorative circle process so that you can see one option that you could choose for your restorative system. So you're going to get two handouts coming here.
Two.